if they have used a donor egg or a donor spermatozoid is not matching it, then the child needs to be adopted. Now, surrogacy would only be the option for patients whom it would be physically or medically impossible or undesirable to carry the baby till term, and there would be payment would be received by the surrogate mother. That is, it was not an altruistic surrogacy. It was a commercial surrogacy, which they told about, and it should be documented and should cover all the genuine expenses. It further said that the responsibility of finding the surrogate should not be with the clinic, but with an ART bank. Not moving ahead. So the what this 2006 guideline said, that the surrogate mother should not be over 45 years and she should not have acted as a surrogate more than 3 times in her lifetime. So it was very liberal. It said that the surrogate mother should not use any IV drugs, blood transfusion, and a known relative or a person can act as a surrogate. Then come the ART Regulation Bill 2010. We have been following it for a very long time now. And this kind of was drafted and was later on, the drafting committee also had the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. So these were more binding to us, even though it was still not passed by the parliament. It described the infertility clinics into 3 levels, the primary, secondary, and tertiary, depending upon the level of work which each clinic does. And it also laid down the minimal requirements, the physical structure of the clinic, as well as the physical requirements of the ART clinic, the staff. It laid down restrictions about the various ART procedures, patient selection, as well as the selection of surrogates. What it meant by the primary infertility clinic are your routine OPDs where you're not handling the egg and the sperm. So it should give, it could be very well your consulting room or your general hospitals. Secondary level are the one which you are doing till the level of IUI. That is, the oocytes were not handled outside the body. And the third ones included everything except for those wherein the research was done on the human embryos. They also had described various forms and various clauses. This is not to scare you, but these are some of the, if you look for any kind of consent forms, you'll be able to find in your this ART draft guidelines 2010. It has got consent forms from everything, right? From IUI till artificial insemination by a donor sperm, donor egg, whatever, consent for freezing, agreement for surrogacy, consent forms. So it basically laid down the rules, prescribed everything. Coming to the important forms, these are your forms R, R1, and R2, which are basically the contract forms between the ART banks and the semen donor or oocyte donor. Now, you need to note that we are not the ART banks. We open the ART clinics. Now, these third-party reproduction always involve an ART bank, and we are not supposed to choose them directly. It is only through these recognized ART banks are we supposed to take this donor oocyte and donor semen and surrogate. All right, and then whenever you're taking a patient, you need to form, you need to have a form a contract between the ART bank, the patient, the ART bank and the clinic, as well as the patient and surrogate. So there's basically 3 binding things which are very important. These come in the form of Form S, Form T, Form U, and then there is another form called the Form of Secrecy, whereby you're not going to divulge any details about the third party reproduction. Now, you're also supposed, the ART bank is also supposed to keep a data of all their donor oocytes and donor sperm.
Ma'am,
it's all, yeah?
Nothing can be seen from the screen, ma'am.
This picture you won't be able to see because it's quite hazy, but you're not able to see anything.
No, ma'am. From this slide, nothing can be seen.
Okay. This one?
No, ma'am.
And then let me connect it to my phone Wi-Fi. I mean, hotspot. Okay. And then give me 1 second.
Yes, ma'am.
They can't see. Screen sharing हो रहा है उसको मेरे ख्याल से वाईफाई कमजोर है तो 2010 was the important one because this was by the drafting committee which was appointed by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare Government of India. So basically it divided the infertility clinics into the various categories like the primary, secondary and tertiary, and lay down rules for minimum requirement of the staff of the clinic and the various procedures. So like I said, the primary clinic were your consultation clinic and the basic hospitals. The secondary one where the patients underwent IUI, and the tertiary ones where everything else was done, like your IVF, ICSI, surrogacy, except for research work on human embryos. And they had described various forms and consent forms. You need not know in details, but then they laid down rules for almost each and everything. Important ones as far as surrogacy is concerned is that there is a contract form between the ART bank surrogate, the ART bank patient, the patient and the surrogate, and the ART bank and the clinic. So basically the ART bank with all of the three parameters and the ART bank with your clinic. Now you as a clinician are not supposed to meet the third party, that is the oocyte donor, the semen donor, or the surrogate directly. You have to hire them from the ART bank. Now these are some of the forms. Minal, can it be seen now or is it still not seen?
Yes, yes, ma'am. It is clear.
Okay, so these are the forms which are by the Government of India, the ART guidelines 2010. This form M is about the oocyte donor, M1, M2 is about the sperm donor. So basically it contains information like you do not write the name of the person, but then they have an identification number, the age, marital status. In case of females, you have the number of deliveries, basically her obstetric history, then the investigations, routinely you have your blood groups and viral markers and the physical examination. Now coming to the consent or the contract between the ART bank and the sperm donor, it says that they are willingly giving it, and it per se does not talk about any charges to be given to them about them, about these services. Then the information on the surrogate is also a similar form. These are like contract forms which I was talking about between the ART bank and the surrogate. This is form R2, and form S is between the ART bank and the patient, which says that the patient, the couple is willingly wanting to have a surrogate from this particular ART bank, and they want their embryos to be transferred into the surrogate. Now this is another contract form. This is form T. This is between the ART bank and the ART clinic, that is between you and the ART bank. And there is one form between the patient and the surrogate called as form U. So important forms as far as surrogacy is concerned is the form R2 between the ART bank surrogate, form S between the ART bank and patient, T between the ART bank and ART clinic, and U between the patient and the surrogate. I don't think you need to know all the form names, but then you just need to know that there are certain forms which need to be filled between the different parties. And like I said, this is form B, the oath of surrogacy form for the clinician. Now, this bill was further revised in 2017, called as the ART Regulation Bill 2017, which extended to the whole of India. Now, basically what it did, it provided certain authorities to regulate the ART procedures, the duties of the ART clinics, ART bank, and it also described the offenses and penalty, which was not the new previous ART bills that is, which was there in 2010 and 2014. So now it also described offenses and penalties like in your PCP and DT Act. And it told us to keep an audited account of all the procedures which we are undertaking. Some of the important things or queries which you can have is, can we share gametes? Well, it said that if you're taking eggs from one donor, you can share it only between two recipients, irrespective of number of eggs you get, provided that each patient gets at least 7 oocytes. So let's say your donor gives,
Please slow down.
Okay, sorry. So coming to gamete sharing, that is egg sharing. Let's say I have one donor egg. That donor egg can provide eggs to two recipients, provided each one of them gets 7 oocytes. Let's say I am one of the recipients and Meenal is the other. So if I want to share it from a third person, then at least I should get 7x, Meenal should get 7x. Only then you're supposed to share. If you're getting lesser than 7x per patient, then you're not going to share. All right. Next is, no women should be treated with gametes or embryos derived from the gametes of more than one man or woman. That is, you're not supposed to mix your embryos or your gametes. I cannot say that, okay, I've got lesser number of eggs, only 5x, so I'll take some from this donor and then give her, let's say, 10x. That cannot be done. So you're not going to share your gametes or the embryos in one treatment cycle. Let's say if this cycle fails, in the next cycle, I can give her another donor or I can give her another sperm. But for this cycle, I'm not going to mix two gametes, which I mean not mixing two sperms, not mixing two embryos, or not mixing two eggs. Let's say the patient says, ki mera thoda sa le lo and take it of the donor. No, you cannot do it. You cannot mix her eggs with the donor eggs. Either she goes ahead with the donor cycle or she goes ahead with her cycle. You cannot mix in the same treatment cycle. Only one sample of semen supplied by the AIT bank should be used only once and only one recipient. So you got one sample, you cannot break it into two and use it for two different patients in the same cycle. That sample has to be used for only one recipient. Have I made this clear? So no mixing of gametes is allowed at all. You should never, never, never mix semen from two individuals. Let's say the husband has oligoacinosospermia. You cannot mix the husband's sample along with the donor semen sample. So any kind of gamete mixing is not allowed. Can I use my close relative or a friend as a donor? As far as the ART guidelines 2017 was concerned, it said no, you cannot use a known sperm or an oocyte donor. It is not allowed. How many oocytes can you harvest? The ART clinic shall harvest the oocyte in accordance to the regulation of the national board. It says, although they have not prescribed any particular number of oocytes, but they said that the donor should not have any complications. As far as the number of oocytes or embryos to be placed back, they have said around 3, but they have still not clearly mentioned it as 3. That's kind of a gray zone. And for any person to undergo IVF, let it be an oocyte donor or a patient, her age should be at least 21 years. You cannot take any donor less than the age of 21 years. Otherwise, you will be legally in a big soup. What should I do if I have got extra gametes? Well, you store all your embryos or oocytes. They are supposed to store them for 5 years. Later on, you need to ask the couple if they want to extend it. They need to give them a certain amount of payment for continuation of the freezing because you need liquid nitrogen and other things to continue. Otherwise, sometimes they say that, okay, discard the embryos. You can discard them, or sometimes they are also given for research. But like I said, the tertiary level clinic, or even that, cannot use the embryos for research. Now, the commissioning parent or the spouse, if it dies, then the embryos automatically becomes for the next living embryo or the spouse, or they can give it for research. Now, the AIT bank may charge an appropriate fees, like I said, for storing of these gametes. Coming to surrogacy, what basically is surrogacy? We all know it's an agreement in which a woman agrees to a pregnancy achieved through assisted reproductive technology in which neither of the gametes belongs to her or her husband. Okay, so she cannot be the genetic parent of that particular baby with the intention of carrying it to term and handing over the child to the person or persons for whom she is carrying the surrogate. Now, when these guidelines were made, it did not say that the a couple who can take it, it needs to be only a heterosexual couple. So the intended carrier could be same-sex couples, heterosexual couples, single women, or a single man. The surrogate man is the surrogate mother is the woman who agrees to have an embryo generated from the sperm of the man who is not her husband, and the oocyte from another woman, which has to be implanted into her uterine cavity, and she carries it to full term and delivers the baby and gives it to her biological parents. All right, so this is clear, is what is surrogacy and what is surrogate mother. Now, what are the rights and duties in relation to surrogacy? Now, once you have decided that this couple needs to undergo surrogacy, you have shortlisted a surrogate, the couple or the individual, as far as this was 2017 guidelines which I'm talking about, it said that they need to sign a surrogacy agreement which is legally bound, legally enforceable between them and the surrogate mother. All the expenses, including if they are giving any insurance to the surrogate related to the pregnancy right till her postpartum 6 weeks, till the child is given back to the biological mother, should be borne by the couple or the individual who are seeking surrogacy. The surrogate mother may also receive monetary compensation. So we are talking about commercial surrogacy, which was allowed as far as this bill, which was till 2017. And they said that further, that the surrogate mother would relinquish all parental rights over the child. They brought down the age of the surrogate to 21 to 35. You remember 2006, they said that the surrogate mother could be up to 45 years. Here they have cut short the age. It's only between 21 and 35 years. And they also added one more clause that the surrogate mother should not deliver more than 5 successful labors, including her own children. So total number of pregnancies which she had delivered should not be beyond 5 because it can increase the chances of maternal death and complications during pregnancy. What they further said that your ART clinic, you are not supposed to advertise to say surrogacy for its clients. All right, so they have replaced the word patients with clients, but you're not supposed to advertise to seek surrogacy. You're supposed to contact the ART bank, and these ART banks will advertise to seek surrogacy. Further, you're not supposed to give in the details regarding the caste, ethnicity, name, descent, or anything of either of the parties. You're not going to tell either of the parents or of the surrogate. No surrogate mother shall undergo embryo transfer more than 3 times for the same couple. Let's say the surrogate does not get pregnant in the first cycle. You repeat it, but you can go only till 3 times. If the surrogate does not conceive in 3 times, you are going to either remove that surrogate, use some other surrogate for the couple. You continuously keep on using the same surrogate. Further, the birth certificate of the baby born through the surrogacy shall bear the name of the individual, because it said that single parents, single men and women can also undergo surrogacy, or individuals who commissioned the surrogacy, and all information would be kept confidential except when you get an order from the court of competent jurisdiction, that is within your locality. Only then you are supposed to divulge the information. Further, it said that the surrogate mother should not act as an oocyte donor for the couple seeking surrogacy. They do not want her to be genetically involved with the baby growing in her womb. Consent of her spouse, that is surrogate spouse, is also necessary. He also signs the agreement. If we see the agreement, what we practically use nowadays, there is a consent form for the surrogate. There is a consent form of the husband. And so all these forms are notarized and they are legal documents. Now, in case if the surrogate is a relative, it's a known, somebody known to me who wants to act as my surrogate, then she should belong to the same generation as the woman desiring the surrogate, which means the mother cannot act as a surrogate for her daughter, a foreigner or a foreign couple. So this was before a recent parliamentary issue was there in 2019. I'll come to that. But earlier they used to allow the foreigners and foreign couples and even the NRIs to seek surrogacy in India, provided they appointed a local guardian who took care of the surrogate and the child. But they needed a proper documentation, a letter from their embassy regarding the same. And they said that further, if I am the patient, then I cannot avail surrogacy from 2 surrogates at a single time. I cannot say that, okay, you transfer my embryos in 1 surrogate and the other also. I take the chance if there are 2 babies, I'll take both of them. No, that is not allowed. Only 1 surrogate can be used at any time. Further, you cannot transfer the embryos simultaneously in the lady as well as the surrogate, by which I mean in the genetic mother as well as the surrogate. So if you're transferring, you transfer either in the genetic mother or in the surrogate. Both cannot be transferred in the same cycle. And only Indian citizens will have the right to act as a surrogate. You cannot have a person brought from outside India and act as a surrogate for your baby. Okay, so only Indian women can act as a surrogate. Further, you cannot send any girl or any lady from here to outside countries for surrogacy. That is also completely not allowed. Now, what about the status of the child which is born? Well, it said that it is the legitimate child of the couple, whether they are married, whether they are unmarried, whether they are single, because whosoever is the commissioning person or the commissioning couple, the child born out of surrogacy is the legitimate child of that particular person. Now, in case the couple divorces, once the child is born, the child shall still be the legitimate child of the couple. What if the woman has used the stored sperms of her dead husband? Well, even then it is the legitimate child of the couple, and the birth certificate will have the name either of the single parent or both the parents. What happens when the child grows up? Let's say the child is 18 years and he wants to know about it. Well, he has the full right to know, except for knowing exactly the name, the personal identification and other things of the donor or the surrogate mother. He can know that he was born through surrogacy, but not exactly who was the surrogate mother, except in life-threatening medical conditions where you actually require the physical testing or samples of the genetic parent, that is the donor, donor egg, donor sperm, or your surrogate mother. And this also you can do only after prior informed consent of the surrogate and the donors, that is the genetic parents, the donor egg and the donor sperm. You cannot just randomly tell it to the boy or the girl. Now, what happened after this? After we had the 2010 and 2009 guidelines, it went to the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. They revised and made another bill. And then in 2016, it came to the cabinet for consideration. Then, like all bureaucratic processes, it took a long time. It proposed a bill to the National Board, State Board, and the National Registry of India for accreditation of all the ART clinics and banks. And then came the surrogacy regulation bill, which was more stringent as compared to your ART regulation 2010, which proposed to legalize altruistic or domestic surrogacy. It said that it wanted to control the exploitation of the surrogate child and mother, which was used for your unethical purposes. The Parliament Standing Committee on Health and Family Welfare further went into it and said it's a need of the hour to regulate all these ART clinics. And therefore, the government reintroduced the 2016 bill in 2019. And in August 2019, the Lok Sabha has promptly passed it. I'll tell you what are the basic differences or the changes in this 2016 bill. Now, Rajya Sabha needs to propose it and send it to the same parliamentary panel before it becomes a law. So, this is the most important thing, the latest. It's the Surrogacy Regulation Bill of 2019. This was a bill to constitute the National Surrogacy Board, State Surrogacy Board, appointment of appropriate authorities for regulation of practice and process of surrogacy for the matters concerned with and thereof incidental to surrogacy. So basically, they appointed certain authorities, the National Surrogacy Board, the State Surrogacy Board, and something called as the appropriate authority to regulate this whole practice of surrogacy. Let's see what they propose. Like I said, it was passed by the Lok Sabha in August 2019 to regulate all these surrogacy clinics, surrogacy procedures, and basically to register all these surrogacy clinics. And also, they lay down certain offenses and penalties like the PCPNDT Act. This act is known as the Surrogacy Regulation Act. It extends to the whole of India except for the state of J&K, Jammu and Kashmir. And it said that it will come into force as such when the central government may be notified by the official gazette, which is not yet done. So what constitutes the National Surrogacy Board? Basically involved a few people from the Ministry of Health, Secretary to the Government of India, members of Parliament, directors of the Director General Health Services. So it's basically composed of a few important people who form the National Surrogacy Board. And then they appointed what is called as the appropriate authority, the state government and the central government. They said within a period of 90 days from the date of commencement of this act, will appoint one or more appropriate authorities for each of the union territories and states. So each of your states and union territories will have an appropriate authority which will kind of legalize these surrogacy clinics and various different things. What does this appropriate authority consist of? It consists of very high ranking officials. You had an officer above the rank of Joint Director Health Family Welfare, and you had eminent women from women's organization, officers from law department, and few eminent RMPs. So very few number of doctors, more from the bureaucratic department, were appointed. I mean, it's supposed to be appointed as the appropriate authority. What they want to do, they wanted to grant, suspend, or cancel the registration. So it kind of became similar to our PCPNDT. We are kind of registering and enforcing the laws against these surrogacy clinics, supervise their implementation, and consider and grant or reject any application of these clinics. So under this law, if it comes into force, then we need to register all our surrogacy clinics under this act. And only when they see your clinic, they supervise it, and only when the appropriate authority says that, okay, your clinic is fine, then your clinic will be registered after paying an appropriate fee like you do for your PCPNDT registration. And once you pay that, within 60 days, you should get your registration done. You can practice surrogacy only when you have this registration. Now, if you get any complaint against your clinic, your registration can be cancelled by these appropriate authorities. It also further laid down very strict punishments for the contravention of the provision of act, which said that if we are not complying with these, there can be a punishment of up to 5 to 10 years and a fine up to 10 lakhs. Further, if the same thing is repeated, there could be a suspension of registration for a period of 5 years from the medical council. So very, very stringent punishments, I would say, if this act come into, like if this bill is passed by the Rajya Sabha also. It's further said that these offenses are cognizable, non-bailable, and non-compoundable. Okay. We were supposed to maintain records of all our surrogacy patients and third-party reproduction, the donor egg, donor sperm, for a period of a whopping 25 years. So long duration of time. We're supposed to keep all these records of the consent forms and other details, the embryological aspects and everything, for 25 years. it defined couples, infertility and infending couples. Now here is what it changed drastically. It defined couple as only legally married Indian males and women. So single men out, single women out, gay couples out, lesbians out, NRIs out, foreigners out. Only legally married Indian male and women above the age of 21 and 18 years were defined as couples. It further defined infertility as inability to conceive for 5 years. So irrespective of whether the woman has a uterus or does not have a uterus, it said that they have to wait for 5 years till the time they could use any of these services. And it further said that the intending couple have to be medically certified. Only then they can use surrogacy. Now, who will certify them? Let's see. The surrogacy, they further described the surrogacy and surrogacy clinic, which was similar to what it was earlier. But then the concept of alloristic surrogacy was advocated by them. They said that it was surrogacy in which there was no charge, expenses, fees or remuneration or monetary incentive of whatever nature given except for the medical expenses which were incurred on the surrogate mother and the insurance coverage for the surrogate mother, either given to the surrogate or her dependents or her representative. So your commercial surrogacy is completely out of picture. Only alloristic surrogacy was allowed as per this act. What it further said that and from the date of commencement of this act, no surrogacy clinic will be allowed to undergo surrogacy unless it is registered under this act. No commercial surrogacy in any form will be allowed. Further, let's say I'm registered to one particular clinic. I cannot have a patient undergoing surrogacy at some other place. I need to be registered at that particular place. So it was more stringent, something like your PCP entity, where you need to be registered to that particular center. You can have your surrogacy only at that particular center. And commercial surrogacy was completely out of picture. We are not supposed to promote, advertise, or any kind of propaganda for aiming to lucre or to induce a woman to act as a surrogate. No promotion of commercial surrogacy. You cannot seek a woman to act as a surrogate mother. So advertising any form was completely banned as far as this act is concerned. What were the rules and regulations as far as surrogacy was concerned? It said that either one or both the members of the couples are suffering from proven fertility, and it's only alloristic surrogacy, not commercial. You're not supposed to produce children for sale, prostitution, exploitation, or any other conditions as prescribed by the board, the national board, which I talked to you earlier. So the director or in charge of the surrogacy clinic or a certain such person who is qualified will see and would record it in writing and provide an essential certificate that yes, this couple will require surrogacy. The intending couple further needs 2-3 things. What are these? First of all, is a certificate of proven infertility from the director of the, from the district medical board. Okay, so first he gets it from the treating doctor and then from the district medical board. He or she, the couple also requires an order concerning the parentage and the custody of the child to be born through surrogacy, which have been passed by the court of magistrate of first class and above, and an online application made by the intending couple and the surrogate mother. Further, they need to provide an insurance coverage to the surrogate for about 16 months, which should be recognized by the Insurance Regulatory Development Authority. So, 3 important things. First is the certificate, which needs to be provided by the district medical board. Next, they need an order from the magistrate. And third, an insurance cover of at least 16 months. So, these 3 things they wanted before the couple can undergo surrogacy. They further said that the age of the intending couple, they capped it. So the female should be between 23 to 50 years and the male should be between 26 to 55 years on the date of certification. They have to be Indian citizens married for at least 5 years and they should not have any surviving child biologically or by adoption or by previous surrogacy. So anybody who has got one child will not be able to offer, will not be offered surrogacy for the second time, provided that the child with the surviving child is mentally or physically challenged or suffers from a life-threatening disorder or fatal illnesses with no permanent cure. And these all need to be further certified by a medical certificate from the district medical board. So your district medical board is a very important entity as far as this act is concerned. for the surrogates also, they said that she should be within the age of 25 to 35 years on the day when you are transferring the embryos, that is on the day of implantation, by which I mean that the day when I'm transferring the embryos back into her womb, the woman needs to be married or ever married. So you can use a widow also, but she needs to be married at least once, and she should have a child of her own. She should not have donated egg or oocyte otherwise. Now, previously what they said that her own eggs cannot be used for the same couple, but here they're completely prohibiting the donors. The donors you cannot take for as surrogates. And they further said that only a close relative of the intending couple can be a surrogate. Now, they have not exactly specified what close relative means, but they have said that only a close relative can be seen, can be used as a surrogate. And she should not provide her own gametes. That is, if their couple is using a donor egg, then the donor should not be the same surrogate who is going to carry the pregnancy. Also, such a woman who acts as a surrogate can do it only once in her lifetime. So once, let's say I'm the surrogate, I can be a surrogate only once in her lifetime, not to be repeated twice or thrice, irrespective of how many children I've got. And also, I need a certificate of medical and psychological fitness that I can undergo surrogacy. So these are the important changes as compared to the previous bills which are there. That is, it needs to be a close relative. It should have to be an aloristic. They capped the age to 25 to 35. Should have been ever married, a child of her own. And you can have surrogacy only once in your lifetime. These are the important changes which were kind of eligibility criteria issued by our appropriate authority. And it said that you cannot push a woman, the husband or the relative cannot push the women to become a surrogate. It is prohibited, and if something thing is done again, this is punishable by the court of law by around 3 years of imprisonment. Further, the surrogate needs to give an informed consent. The clinician needs to explain the whole surrogacy procedure, the side effects and everything to the surrogate. And you need to have a written informed consent from the surrogate. Now, the surrogate can withdraw her consent even on the day of embryo transfer. So before her embryo transfer, the very same day also, she can withdraw her consent. She can say, no, I don't want to be a surrogate. So they have given more power to the surrogate by this act. Further, they have tried and strengthened the prohibition of abandoning, because there were many case reports where the child had any kind of medical illnesses or because of certain visa problems, the genetic parents have just left their child who was just born. So the law has made it more stringent that the intending couples will not abandon their child born out of surrogacy, irrespective of whether the child has got any genetic defect, birth defects, mental conditions, medical conditions, sex of the child, or defects developing later on in life. And this child would be deemed as the biological child and would be entitled to all the legitimate rights and privileges. So they have tried to secure the rights of these child which would be born through surrogacy. Why was there so much of uproar against this bill? Why did they said that, oh, it's just a casual approach to a very serious concern? Let's look at the other side. Now, why exactly was this bill proposed, the surrogacy bill 2019? Because of the rampant use of the rampant commercialization, unethical practices, exploitation of the surrogate mothers, abandonment of the child. And there were also cases of import of embryos. The embryos were just imported from one country to another. So they wanted to protect the rights of these surrogate women and their children. And therefore, they proposed your surrogacy boards at the national level, state level, kind of prepared an appropriate authority, thought of banning the commercial surrogacy, laid down severe imprisonment, and only said that yes, it would be only ethical aloristic surrogacy. But what are the problems like? Most importantly, you first need to regulate the ART clinics before you're trying to regulate the surrogacy. So first you need to know what are the number of ART clinics in that particular region, and you need to regulate them. It has not defined what does this mean by close relative, and even the concept of infertility, like couple being married for 5 years. Now, if the woman has got Asherman syndrome or does not have uterus or has undergone obstetric hysterectomy, why does she need to wait for another 5 years and only then she can avail surrogacy? And what exactly do you mean by close relatives? Who are the close relatives? That was the problem. And there was the other side of it, that these close relatives, the women could be further exploited because of family pressure, because that, you know, that you cannot have surrogate from anywhere else. You are going to pressurize the other women of the family. And there could be an acute shortage of these women, of these surrogates, because you're not commercially getting them. So probably it will lead to more problems with the women rather than addressing the problem. Now, it further said that you're reversing the burden of proof on the accused. Like on the, everything is coming on the doctors. The non-doctors need to get various documents and everything to kind of start the procedure. Also, even if the woman has miscarried or there is any problem, you need a written permission from the authority for even undergoing a DNC or an abortion. And it is not specified correctly the various procedures to it. That was all about the surrogacy and the AIT bills. Dr. Meena told me that you also wanted something about the clinical aspects of surrogacy. So, do you want me to take it? There will be some 10 slides or something, Meena?
Yes, ma'am. You can continue.
Okay. So, these are basically the clinical aspects. Now, we all know, as far as concerned, the surrogacy bill 2019 is still not become a law. So, this is what we are practically following. We are trying to follow as much as the guidelines are there. But yes, commercial surrogacy is followed. We also do commercial surrogacy till now because the law has not yet been passed. Now, if you get a question on surrogacy per se, this is what you need to write. So, surrogacy is basically a method of assisted reproduction. Surrogate itself originates from the Latin word surrogatus, which means submission, to act in place of. So, traditionally, we had your traditional or natural surrogacy and your gestational surrogacy. Traditional surrogacy, of course, is banned by the ICMR. It is no longer followed, in which the surrogate was the genetic mother of the baby, by which it means that the surrogate was inseminated with the sperms from the male partner of the infertile couple, and we used either it was done either through an IUI or an IVF after taking the eggs of the surrogate. So the child was genetically related to the surrogate and to the male partner of the infertile mother, who was the legal mother. So this is now completely out of picture, completely banned, but just for completion's sake I have added this. Then you had your gestational surrogacy. And now you have your altruistic and commercial. Altruistic is like you do not take anything. The surrogate does not take any compensation. And commercial is where the surrogate takes some compensation. So your gestational surrogacy is what which is being used nowadays. Is where the woman carries the pregnancy created by the egg and the sperm of the commissioning couple. The egg of the wife is fertilized by the husband's sperm by IVF or ICSI. And the embryo, which is the genetic child of the infertile couple, is transferred back into the surrogate. The surrogate carries the pregnancy for 9 months, delivers the baby, and gives the baby back to the intending couple. Thereby, the child is not at all genetically linked to the surrogate. This is called a gestational surrogacy, which could be either altruistic or commercial. But ICMR has, the government has in fact now kind of banned the commercial surrogacy also. What are the indications? Anything where you do not have a uterus, maybe congenital absence of the uterus in Mullerian agenesis, where the woman may have undergone hysterectomy for maybe cancers or hemorrhage in the previous cesarean section, obstetric hysterectomy or a ruptured uterus. When you have severe malformations of the uterus, you have either a unicornate uterus, bicornate uterus, and she has repeated maybe preterm deliveries or abortions in the second trimester or something like that. Or sometimes when the endometrium is thoroughly damaged because of tuberculosis, leading to intrauterine adhesions or Asherman syndrome, and then the lady just cannot conceive. Or sometimes when there is a high risk of any complication during pregnancy, like rupture of the uterus because of previous various surgeries on the uterus, like previous many myomectomies or previous history of ruptured uterus. In those cases, I will not want that lady to undergo pregnancy again. Or when you have repeated miscarriages, repeated IVF failures, or you do not know what is the cause exactly. Sometimes there could be problem with the endometrium in spite of doing it many times, in spite of transferring good embryos, the lady is just not getting pregnant. In those cases, you can offer surrogacy. Or let's say the lady has got medical problems like say, chronic renal failure, heart diseases, or in such conditions where pregnancy itself will be very harmful to the lady, or RH incompatibility between the couples. Now, all this could be the indications for surrogacy. Previously, we had gay couples and lesbians, which are not allowed nowadays. Now, till now, the law is not yet passed, so we can have a different combination. So this can be wife sex with the husband's sperm and the embryo transferred in the surrogate. Then you can have the donor's sperm with the wife's egg or the donor egg with the husband's sperm or both the donors and having a donor embryo transferred in the surrogate. So these are the four different combinations in which the embryo can be transferred into the surrogate of a legally married couple. How do we choose the surrogate? This is what practically we do in our clinic. So generally a lady between 21 and 35 years of age is chosen. Now, this is what we use in our clinic currently. The the surrogacy bill now sits between 25 to 35. But previously we're using between 21 and 35 years of age. Married women with previously normal healthy babies. We used to take a detailed medical, surgical, personal history that there was no history of blood transfusion, any kind of addiction uneventful obstetric history, no miscarriages, the antenatal, intranatal, postnatal period was uneventful. We screened the lady, that is the surrogate and her husband, for all your infectious diseases, the STDs, VDRL, hepatitis, B, C, HIV, and also thalassemia screening is done. Then her endometrium is evaluated in the natural cycle to see whether the endometrium is nice, triple line, and later on we also do a Doppler study to see the receptivity of the endometrium. Once the surrogate is finalized, then a legal and financial agreement is made between the surrogate, commissioning couple, and the ART bank as per the guidelines which were laid down by the ICMR as per the ART Bill 2017, the forms which I showed you, form R, R1 and all. And all these forms are signed, and only then do we initiate the medical process of induction and transferring the embryo. So what we do, let's say my genetic mother is here and my surrogate is here. I put both of them on oral contraceptive pills because I need to match their cycles. Now, on the day 20, 21, let's say I need to do the IVF on the next month. So on this month, when the surrogate is on OC pills, I'll give her a suppressant, that is GnRH analog depo. We generally give Lipride depo on day 20, 21, 22 of her menstrual cycle. Then the surrogate is put on estrogen tablets to prime the uterus. In the meantime, when the surrogate bleeds, let her continue with the estrogen tablets. When the genetic mother bleeds, she started on an ovulation induction protocol, which can be either your agonist or antagonist, depending upon the age, AMH, and other factors. So if it is an antagonist protocol, you start the injections from the second day, the gonadotropins, HMG, or FSH. You do the monitoring of the cycle. When the follicle reaches 14 millimeters, you start the antagonist to prevent the endogenous LH surge. Similarly, in your long protocol, the analogs are started from day 21 here. Daily doses of GnRH analogs are given in very less dose, 0.5 ml daily. And then when she gets her periods, we start them with the stimulation, that is the HMG, gonadotropins injection, or the FSH. Again, we monitor the cycle. So basically, in both the cases, you're going to monitor the cycle. And once the follicle reaches, at least you have three follicles of 17, 18 millimeters, then you give the trigger. Trigger is for the final maturation of the oocytes. After that, your oocyte retrieval is programmed 34 to 36 hours later. In the meanwhile, when everything is happening simultaneously, you're scanning the surrogate and looking for an endometrial growth. The endometrium should be nice, triple line, at least more than 7.5 millimeters. You can add adjuvants to improve her endometrial lining, like your allogenin, sometimes sildenafil is added, ecosprin is added. And on the day, now there are two thoughts. Some people add your progesterone on the day of HCG injection, that is on the day of trigger, and some people start it on the day of oocyte retrieval. In our clinic, we generally start from the day of oocyte retrieval. This progesterone is added to the surrogate in the form of either oral, vaginal, or injectable progesterone. So the endometrium now becomes receptive to receive the baby. So you are trying to mimic the natural cycle in the surrogate. Now, when the oocyte retrieval, the day of the surgery is there, when you're trying to remove the eggs, the same day the genetic father gives the semen sample, IVF is conducted with the genetic eggs, the eggs from the genetic mother fertilized with the father, and then the embryo which is formed is transferred either on day 3 or day 5, either the blastocyst or the cleavage cell, under the ultrasound guidance in the surrogate. And we put the surrogate on luteal support, that is again progesterone tablets and injections are continued along with estrogen to support the pregnancy. And like in any IVF procedure, the pregnancy is confirmed after a blood test and after 2 weeks. If it is positive, then the lady keeps on following up like any IVF pregnancy. And what was done in commercial surrogacy was that at every stage of her, like at every milestone, when the beta HCG is positive, when the cardiac activity is there, at the level of nipple scan. Now, these are all laid down in her legal and financial agreement, what amount needs to be paid to the surrogate and to her agent and the ART bank. So, this amount is given by the ART bank to the surrogate and throughout the pregnancy. And then the surrogate delivers and gets admitted and delivers and then gives hand over the baby to the genetic parents. So this is basically how the surrogacy procedure is done. Okay, I think I'm at the end of it.
Yes, ma'am.
Any questions?
Yes, ma'am. Question box.
Yes.
Time box is full.
1 second.
Yes, ma'am. Kedar sir has not joined it. So
okay, can you just ring him up?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm not able to see. Okay, so there are some questions, plenty of them. Minal, will you tell me the questions or should I read them and answer them? I cannot hear her.
Hello, ma'am?
Hello?
Ma'am, sir has joined. So, what you want to continue or should I ask sir to... Hello, ma'am? Hello, ma'am?
Hello? Tell Rana to finish the questions. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Let Rana finish the questions.
Okay, sir. Fine, sir. Yes, sir. Ma'am, can you hear me? Rana, ma'am? Rana, ma'am? Rana, ma'am?
Hello, Minal, ask her to unmute herself.
Sir, she is unmuted only, but she can't be...
But she's talking, but you cannot hear.
Rana, ma'am? Yes, ma'am. Can I ask you questions and you can answer? Ma'am, not able to hear you. Ma'am? Yes, ma'am. More louder, ma'am.
No.
Ma'am, please check your network connection. It is low.